It's finally time to look at some specific examples of solutions to the wave equation. What we're going to do here is use the D'Alembert formula that we derived in the last video and basically plug in different values for the functions f and g so that we get the solution to this initial value problem. And then we'll look at the solutions, decide if they make sense. Our first example would be pretty standard. We'll take f of x to be basically a step function. Let's call it box of x. And that'll be a function which steps up to the value of 1 for x between minus 1 and 1, and it's 0 otherwise. For g, we'll take just 0. If you remember that f of x is like our initial position for the string and g is the initial velocity, this is like physically like stretching the string into the shape of a step function, which looks like this. It is 0 until it reaches the point minus 1, then it steps up to 1, and then it becomes 0 again. So it's like stretching the string into this shape. You can think of these jumps as being just very sharp stretches. And then just releasing it and seeing what happens. So what does D'Alembert's formula say will happen? Well, the g part is 0, so we don't have to worry about this integral. So we'll just have a sum of two f's. F is this box. So we'll have u of xt equals 1/2 box of, let's take c equals 1, just to be simple, box of x plus t plus 1/2 box of x minus t. So what is this? Well, it's a sum of two waves, one traveling to the left and one traveling to the right. Both of these waves have the same shape as the original guy, but only half the height. So these are half height boxes moving to the left and the right. I should say two of them. All right, I made an animation in Mathematica. Let's take a look. So what we're looking at here is the graph of u at the initial time, t equals 0, which is the same as the picture that I drew down here. And as I play the animation, you'll see the two half-height boxes move away from each other at the speed c equals 1. So at the initial time, you see that the two half heights add together to be a total height of 1, but then they start moving apart. Now, if you think about it for a minute, you realize that the fact that I used a box function here is really just irrelevant. If g is 0, then the D'Alembert solution will just be this 1/2 times the combination, the sum of the two f's, one moving to the left and one moving to the right. So really, whatever initial profile I start out with, when I let the wave equation do its work, I'll just see two half-height f's moving apart in different directions. All right, let's do another example. Just in case you think now that taking g to be 0 is just super boring, let's take f to be cosine x. And you'll see that actually something kind of interesting happens. So our initial shape is just cosine x. And then the D'Alembert formula will say that u must be 1/2. Let's take c equals 1 again. Cosine x plus t plus 1/2 cosine x minus t. All right, so just two cosine waves moving to the left and the right. Let's see what that looks like. So here's the animation. We see the initial profile of just cosine x. And let's see what happens when we let the wave equation do its thing. So it's a standing wave. Maybe you expected that, maybe you didn't. It certainly doesn't look offhand like a sum of a wave traveling to the left and a wave traveling to the right, but that is what it is. In fact, if you remember your trig identities and you look up the sum identity for cosine, you'll see that this, in fact, is equal to the cosine of t times the cosine of x. And that looks a little bit more like the graph that we were looking at. It's the cosine x multiplied by this cosine t, which is making it oscillate back and forth. Since this is kind of an interesting example, I made another animation where we see in solid black the original function u, and in blue we'll see the left moving wave, and in red we'll see the right moving wave. Now the black line is the sum of the two, so it's the combination of the heights. So you see how this one standing wave can be a sum of two traveling waves moving in opposite directions. Okay, we've looked at non-zero f and zero g. So let's take f to be zero now, and let's take g to be the box function. Just a quick reminder, that's 1 and 0. 1 for x between minus 1 and 1, and 0 for all other values. So now we have to use D'Alembert's formula. The f part won't contribute anything, that's just 0, so we have to evaluate this integral. Now to evaluate this integral, let's try to compute an antiderivative of the box function, little g. I can take any old antiderivative. So I will take an antiderivative, which is the integral from 0 to x of the box function. And let's call that integral ramp. You'll see it in a minute why I would want to call it ramp. So let's see what that looks like. Well, first I'll draw the box function again real quick. What does it do? Well, it cruises along at 0 until you hit minus 1, then it bumps up to 1, and then it goes back down to 0 again. So this is happening at values minus 1 and 1, and this is a height of 1. Well, what's the ramp function going to look like? So I cruise along, if I'm starting here at 0, I cruise along in the positive direction, and I'm going to increase linearly until I hit 1, at which point I'll settle out. So it just increases as a line until it gets to the value of 1, and then it flattens out. On the other hand, if I integrate from 0 to a negative value of x, I'm going to decrease linearly because I'm integrating backwards. So I'll decrease linearly until I get to a total area of 1 that I've picked up, and then I'm going to settle out. So I'll go down to a minus 1, and then go flat. So you can see why I might want to call it ramp. Kind of looks like a ramp, right? You drive or walk up this thing, get up to higher ground here. Okay, so let's see what D'Alembert's formula says the solution is. I'll have u of xt equals, now the f part again is 0, and so I'll just look at the g part, and I'll take c equals 1 again, just for convenience, so it's 1 half integral from x minus t up to x plus t of the box function, which is 1 half ramp of x plus t minus 1 half ramp of x minus t. Okay, good. So we have two ramp functions. We have 1 half height ramp function moving to the left, and we have 1 half height ramp function moving to the right, except there's a negative there. So it's actually the difference of these two guys. So let's imagine that this picture here is now the half height ramp function, just so I can reuse it. Even though when I originally drew it, it was full height. So this will be now a height of 1 half. And the negative of the ramp function we'll also draw on there. That's just this guy reflecting it about the x-axis. And so what this picture is it's the sum of these two ramp functions, this pink one being the negative ramp function, and the one in green is moving to the left, and the one in pink is moving to the right. So let's see what this looks like. Okay, so I've got a nifty animation made up here. So remember, what we're going to be watching is these two waves, this pink ramp moving to the right and this green one moving to the left, both at a speed of 1. And it just continues on like that. So you can see at the very beginning, immediately a small little strip of length 1 begins to rise up. Oh, there's something funky going on there, but begins to rise up until it hits the height of 1, and then it just sort of spreads. You can see the two sides of the ramps there. Now, physically, what this corresponds to, you can think of it as an initial velocity, which is a velocity of 1 for a small little segment of the string, and 0 otherwise. So it's a little bit like a gentle tap from a hammer of width 2, which is centered at the origin. That's kind of the way that you should imagine the physical situation here. Hopefully those few examples gave you a more concrete feel for the D'Alembert formula and for initial value problems for the wave equation in general. So what I'd like to do now is just end with a kind of a question. And that question is, what about boundary conditions? So I haven't said explicitly, but I have been assuming that the domain of definition of the wave equation and of these solutions is the entire line. So the string is infinitely long. What now if I want to impose a condition? Let's say that I have my string, and I have it stretched out, and it goes off to infinity in this direction. So dot 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 dot. But then I stand here and I hold it on this end, and I hold it fixed. So I'm going to fix this end. So let's say this is at the point x equals 0. And so what I'm doing is I'm imposing the condition u of 0 t equals 0. So in other words, this endpoint is fixed for all time. Now the question that I'll ask you is the D'Alembert formula still valid? Is there any way that I could use the D'Alembert formula to get a solution to this problem? Another natural problem would be if I was to fix both ends of the string. So now the string has just a finite length, and somebody stands on either end holding on to the ends of the string. And let's say that this is x equals 0, and this is x equals L, or something like that. And so now what I'm doing is imposing two boundary conditions. So u of 0 t equals 0, and u of L t equals 0. So you could cook up other situations. But the general question here is, how would I solve problems like this? So you've got lots to think about at this point, but let me give you a kind of a practical exercise just to practice with the D'Alembert formula. I want you to solve the initial value problem above with f of x equals 0 and g of x equals sine of x. Okay, so you get a little practice using the D'Alembert formula. But some other things to do would be to play with the solution, see if you can use, say, like a trig identity on it to get a little better handle on what it is. Convince yourself that it's reasonable. Maybe try to use a piece of software to animate it or graph it. Try using MATLAB or Mathematica, etc. Okay, so till next time.